Hey there. I'm Andrei. I'm a principal engineer at Atlassian. And today we're going to spend a bit of time talking about APIs, GraphQL, and some of the takeaways that we have running GraphQL at scale at Atlassian. So for the past 4 years, I've spent the majority of my time working on Compass, Atlassian's developer experience portal. When we started working on Compass, we knew we wanted to build it API first. We wanted to build a product for developers by developers. And most of the things that we wanted from a developer experience portal, we'd need an API that was robust and provided access to all the functionality of the product. We also knew that we'd want to have the product be fully extensible. And as an engineer, there are a few things that are more annoying than having to write an extension and then finding out that the API that I wanted to use for that extension either doesn't exist or behaves slightly differently than it does in the end product functionality. Additionally, we wanted to be able to leverage the plethora of services across the Atlassian ecosystem and build on top of the great work done by other teams across the organization. So let's take the Compass component overview screen as an example. All of these are extension points that leverage Forge, Atlassian's serverless app platform. So all of these parts of the application must execute calls against Forge services in order to render content for the user. For ownership information, Compass leverages Atlassian Teams. That allows Compass to only store a team identifier for ownership information on our end and let the Teams platform do the heavy lifting. Teams, in turn, doesn't store any user profile information and instead relies on Atlassian Identity Platform for that data. You can probably tell there are a lot of calls that we could potentially make in order to populate this whole page and a number of ways to structure the services needed in order to serve this data. So let's go through the options. The first option would be to just make one call per service that we need to reach out to. Now, if this seems slow, it's because it most likely will be. Each call would need to go through Atlassian's edge services, and the calls would most likely be sequential. For something like the component overview page, we'd need to get the component, look at the team ID, get the team information from the team platform, and then finally run the call to retrieve the profiles for the users on that team once we get the data from the team's platform. All right, so we can do better. One of the shortcuts that we could take would be to just have Compass make those calls. Our users would then only have to make one HTTP call, and Compass would just do the coordination work. This would make the pull process less complex for our clients, and it would shave some latency off our service calls because they'd all be happening in the same geo. The issue here is that it places a lot of complexity on Compass as a service, and all this complexity is kind of undifferentiated heavy lifting. It's just like fetching data back and forth, and it's not complexity that's core to our product. So further iteration here would be to leverage the backend for frontend pattern and just spin up a service whose only job it is to figure out what data our frontend needs and then go fetch it from our various dependencies and smush it all together. Smush is obviously the technical term for this operation. Now this works and it shares some benefits with the prior options with the added benefit that now we've abstracted the complexity of constructing bespoke responses for our frontend out of the core service and we've isolated it into a service where we can potentially make it more generic. So what if this backend for frontend were generic? We could have the gateway serve a number of endpoints configured to hydrate data from all our other services and ensure that our clients only got the data they actually needed, and no product teams would need to maintain the service that just provide configuration for their endpoints. So with REST, this ends up being somewhat more complicated, and it's mostly due to the fact that there's so many permutations of service dependencies possible that we'd most likely end up with an overwhelming number of endpoints and payloads to support. There's also no functionality that would allow REST calls to filter what specific data they needed without building something bespoke. With GraphQL, however, there's an increasingly common pattern. So if you look online for schema stitching, schema federation, or composite schemas, these are all slight variations on the same problem. And so that's how Compass ended up using GraphQL. Now for the rest of the session to make a bit more sense, it would probably be useful to do a quick GraphQL speedrun in order to give everyone a sense of what this all looks like. So GraphQL is a query language for APIs and a runtime for fulfilling those queries with your existing data. GraphQL provides a complete and understandable description of the data in your API, gives clients the power to ask for exactly the data they need and nothing more, and makes it easier to evolve APIs over time and enables powerful developer tools. All right, now that we've all read the first paragraph of the GraphQL documentation, let's kick this thing around for a bit and see exactly what it looks like. So let's start with types. Types define the data that your services will return. The syntax is fairly easy to grok. And in this case, we're defining the component type along with its fields and their types. So we will have field ID of type ID. The ID type essentially means that this is a string, but it's not meant to be human readable. So an ID. The exclamation mark at the end specifies that this field cannot be null. And the other fields are named component type, and they're both string and both nullable. Operations in GraphQL are either queries, mutations, or subscriptions. Today, we'll mostly look at the first two and not really talk about the third one. So queries are defined as fields on a GraphQL query type. So in this case, for instance, we've defined a component query that takes a non-nullable argument ID of type ID and returns a component. So GraphQL is protocol agnostic. That is to say, per the spec, you should be able to use it with whatever transport layer you want, and it really doesn't care. Now, mostly we're going to be using it over HTTP, but let's sort of abstract that away and say, like, we're looking at this over some idealized wire, and this is the query that we would run, right? So like we would ask for component with ID one and ask for the name and component type, and we would get some JSON back. Cool. So one of the nicer things about GraphQL is that it allows the client to only ask for the data that they actually need. So with REST, for instance, if we were to get component with ID one, we would pretty much get all the data in the component. With GraphQL, we can pick which exact fields we want. So in this case, we would just ask for the name and promptly get just the name back. This ends up being really useful because it makes clients less brittle. It lets them only ask for the data that they know they need, and it lets API providers get a better sense of which fields that clients are actually using. This ends up being super useful when doing deprecations or when trying to assess the progress of migrations to newer APIs. So we've gone through querying data, and mutations would be the next logical step. Mutations are how we tell GraphQL to change things. The process of defining a mutation is fairly similar to defining a query. We are just going to add a new field on a mutation type. So in this case, we're defining the create component mutation that takes two arguments, name and component type. Both are non-nullable and both are string, and it returns a component. So much like queries, when we run a mutation, the client can choose which fields from the returning type they actually need. In this case, we're going to create a component, and then we're going to ask for the ID and the name of that component. Sure enough, we get everything back in JSON. So let's get to the graph bit of GraphQL. Your GraphQL schema can define relationships between the various types. So in this case, we're going to define a user type and then a team type that has a field called members that is a list of users. So let's try using this, and let's add it to our initial component type. You'll see that we now have the field owner, and that is the type team. So how we'd be able to query it? We would ask for a component, ID one. We're gonna want the name of the component, and then we're gonna ask for the owner. The owner is gonna be a team. We're gonna ask for the name of that team, and for each member of that team, we want their name as well. And sure enough, we get everything back just the way that I expected it to be. So that's about it. Congratulations, you now know enough GraphQL to be dangerous. So if you scale this all out, you can see how it will do the trick in allowing clients to define exactly the data they need across multiple services and allow them to navigate a large graph of dependent entities. So our end state here is that we have a GraphQL gateway service that coordinates the whole process of fetching information that our clients ask for from the respective services. All of the services on the right have their own GraphQL schema that they expose to the GraphQL gateway. The GraphQL gateway in turn has its own schema definition that it exposes to external clients. This schema also defines what service the GraphQL gateway should call in order to retrieve a specific resource. So when a client asks for a component and the owner of that component, the gateway knows that it should make a request to Compass to retrieve the component. Subsequently, it should make a request to the Teams platform to retrieve the team, and then a request to the identity platform in order to retrieve a batch of users. GraphQL on its own doesn't really solve all of this, but it provides a great foundation to allow this functionality to be implemented. Now, Atlassian opted to build our own gateway, mostly because we had very specific requirements in terms of the capabilities we needed from the gateway. But since the market sort of matured, and so if you want to use some of this functionality like without needing to invest in building everything from scratch, there are a lot of really solid off-the-shelf solutions that you might be able to leverage. All right, so given all that context, let's talk a little bit about the takeaways we've had in both developing Compass as a product on top of GraphQL and in running the GraphQL gateway as a platform service. So the lifecycle of your APIs is most likely going to be something pretty similar to this. You'll have an initial phase of experimentation where your APIs are going to undergo a quick succession of changes as teams discover exactly what they need from your APIs. And then they'll be stable for a while and evolve as usage shifts. And at some point, they're going to be deprecated in favor of some newer, shinier APIs. One of the features of GraphQL is allowing clients to dig into the schema and run queries against it. This is really powerful in allowing users to make use of code completion tools in order to write queries and mutations. But the downside is it can end up exposing functionality that isn't quite ready for prime time. This ended up being a bit of an issue for us and making engineers feel like they needed to have their schemas be 100% perfect and done before rolling out the functionality. That made them spend a lot more time putting schemas together rather than just experimenting with the schemas and trying to test them out end to end and see exactly what sort of data they needed and how it all fit together. The way we got around it was to add an annotation to our schema that would force clients to opt into using operations that were not fully baked. So clients can determine what their own risk profile is when using these APIs. For instance, for clients with fast feedback loops, like the Compass single page web application, we're comfortable using these experimental APIs because we're in control of both the client and the server, and we know the pace at which these two things are going to get updated. Clients running in development or one-off scripts that are not mission critical have a different risk profile than production applications, so these clients can still use experimental queries if they opt into them. For everybody else, the rest of our APIs abide by our slower-moving six-month deprecation policy. All right. As your API evolves, some of the things we've seen developers need more guidance around have been nullability and breaking changes. These are both, honestly, facets of a similar problem. Nullability is tricky mostly because having a field go from non-nullable to nullable is a breaking change due to the fact that it means that clients who weren't dealing with a value possibly being null would end up breaking once that change is rolled out. So these changes end up needing to go through a full deprecation cycle with all the ceremony that goes with it. I'm calling out nullability specifically because it's really tempting on the first cut of a schema to have everything just be non-nullable, because at that particular point in time, things happen to be non-nullable. That changes, though, as your APIs evolve. So our current guidance for engineers is to make all fields on their types nullable from the get-go and then change the fields to non-nullable only if them not being present would invalidate the whole object. Now, breaking changes in general have their own sharp edges, and we've had reasonable success in integrating breaking change detection tooling in our CI pipeline in order to make sure that engineers know when they're possibly introducing breaking changes. So if you can do it, highly recommend it. All right, deprecation is pretty straightforward, and GraphQL has a built-in annotation that we can use for it. The main process change I think we've added to this has been adding the date in our deprecation messages just to let clients know exactly when changes are going to happen. And also to some degree to make sure that teams remember to actually affect those changes. All right. Schema consistency. There are a couple of things here, but let's start with naming. Reigning champ for hardest problem in computer science, 50 years running. So in our current setup, with a lot of services maintaining their own schemas, it is extremely likely that two of them will end up defining the same type. So say Compass defines the type tag, and then the identity platform defines the same type tag. This is in itself isn't a problem until we try to have this type exposed to external customers via the GraphQL gateway. And at that point, we have to choose. Either one of the types doesn't get surfaced in the overall schema, or one of the types gets renamed, or both of them get renamed. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter which one of them gets renamed or if it's both. What matters is that the renaming process is consistent and we're abiding by the same rule. So Atlassian, what we've landed on is prefixing service-specific types with the product name. So in this case, we'd have Compass tag or identity tag if we were to run into this. At the end of the day, it's mostly a matter of preference. The most important thing is to have a consistent rule around it and to follow it. So similarly to types, naming conventions around how fields are named are helpful in making your API feel more consistent and having it be easier to use for your clients. So if the way that you get a component out of your API is components or get components or get compass components or get compass, get component for compass or fetch component, those are all fine as long as you're consistent about it and you're using the same notation, the same convention across like all of your APIs. All right. If you're running multi-tenant systems, having a consistent pattern for identifying tenants in whose context the query is being run is likely to be useful in the long run, especially if you're trying to move functionality out of your underlying services into the gateway. Think about things like rate limiting or OAuth scope checks. Those types of things really benefit from having this information available to your gateway. All right, last but not least, ownership. Turns out that it's really useful to know who to get in touch with when running a gateway. So for one case, incidents, you need to know who to page if you're seeing issues with the underlying services. The other case is just updates, deprecation notices, changes to the platform, things that are non-critical, but are really pertinent to service owners. At Atlassian, the way that we run this is for both of these use cases, we've been using Compass. That's been working out pretty great, but granted, I might be biased. Whatever you end up using, make sure that you have defined your escalation channels for these services so that you know how to reach out to the service owners when something goes awry. All right. So what's next? Should you ditch REST and just use GraphQL for everything? Probably not. But if you are using GraphQL inside of your organization, you should explore centralizing tooling and processes around GraphQL and rolling out a gateway potentially for cross-service data access. It's worked out great for us and we can only recommend it. All right, that's all I had for today. Thank you so much for your time and I hope you have an amazing rest of your conference. I'll see you around, friends.